Hello everyone. Last time we have explained about common sarism. Today we are going to explain the next type of animal association, that is mutualism. Mutualism is a Latin term. Mutuus means to exchange. So in this case, there is an exchange of the needs or the requirements of the two different organisms belonging to various species. In this association, both the partners are beneficial to each other and exchanging their needs or the metabolites. Means the two partners or the two organisms belonging to two different species, both are exchanging their requirements or the needs or the metabolites, and thus both are benefited due to the mutualism type of relationship or the association. Without support of one, another partner cannot survive. Without the support of one partner, another cannot survive. Means there is a physiological interdependence or a close relationship. Both the partners show physiological interdependence. In this association, each of the interacting species functions as both host and parasite. Means both the partners of the relationship acts as a host as well as a parasite for both. For example, the wood-eating termites and a flagellate protozoan called Euglena. Termites live in the moist, decaying trunks of the trees and feed upon wood containing cellulose. So cellulose is the major food of the termite, but the termites are unable to digest it because of absence of enzyme cellulase. Means the termites cannot synthesize the enzyme cellulase. But its mutualist, that is the flagellate protozoan Euglena, lives in the intestine of the termite and provides this enzyme cellulase, which is useful for the digestion of the cellulose. So the protozoan or the Euglena getting shelter in the gut or the digestive tract of the termites, as well as it hydrolyzes the cellulose or digests the cellulose. So cellulose is finally converted into glucose in presence of enzyme cellulase synthesized or provided by the flagellate protozoan like Euglena. So on the digestion of the cellulose, cellulose is converted to glucose, and which is utilized or used by both the partners, that is termites as well as the flagellate protozoans. If the flagellates are removed from the gut, if the flagellates are removed from the hindgut of the termite, they suffer from starvation, or this may lead to the death of the termites. So the flagellate protozoans also can't survive anywhere except in the intestine of the termites. So this is a mutualism type of relationship or the association between the wood-eating termite and the flagellate protozoans. So both of the partner, that is wood-eating termites and the flagellate protozoans, cannot survive without another, because there is a physiological interdependence. So flagellate requires the protection and the nutrition that is supplied by the termites for its survival, or it cannot live into certain into another host organism. And in return, the flagellate protozoans provides the enzyme cellulase, which will not be synthesized by the termites, and thus termites cannot survive without the flagellate protozoans. And since the flagellate protozoans provides the enzyme cellulase for the digestion of the cellulose to the termites. So both the partners, wood-eating termites and the flagellate protozoans, are interdependent on one another, or there is a physiological interdependence, and which cannot survive, both cannot survive without another, and this is thus a mutualism type of relationship where both the partners of the relationship are benefited. The second example, the honeybees and the flowers. The honeybees fly or moves from flower to flower in search of the nectar and pollen, which they transform into the food which benefits these insects. Means the honeybees getting the pollen grains and the nectar as a food from the flowers. On the other hand, whenever the honeybees are moving from flower to flower, the pollen grains or the particles of the pollen attach to their body, and such particles are then transported to other flowers and resulting into a cross-pollination of the flowers for the flowering plants. This is the relationship of the mutualism in which the honeybees obtain the food and the plant reproduces itself due to the cross-pollination service provided by the honeybees. So this relationship between the honeybees and the flowers is called as a symbiosis or the mutualism. So in this case also, the honeybees are getting nectar and pollen as a food source from the variety of flowering plants, and in return the honeybees provides the cross-pollination service for the reproduction of the flowering plants. So this is also a association or the relationship between the bees and flowers representing the relationship of the symbiosis or the mutualism. Then another one example, that is a cleaning symbiosis or a cleaning symbiosis or the mutualism in a fish by prawns or the shrimps. So cleaning symbiosis is mutually beneficial. Cleaning symbiosis is a mutually beneficial association between the individuals of the two species, where one partner, that is a cleaner, removes and eats the parasites and other materials from the surface of the other partner, that is a client. For example, the cleaner shrimps, belonging to class Crustacea of the phylum Arthropoda. So the cleaner shrimps or the prawns clean the teeth of the moray eels or a fish, moray fish or moray eels, and also feeds the bit of food particles. So whatever the food particles obtained while removing or while cleaning the teeth, whatever the food particles or the bit of the food particles are obtained, that are consumed as a food by the cleaner shrimps. So cleaner shrimp providing a service of cleaning of the teeth of the moray eels, and in return the cleaner shrimps get the bit of food particles from the eel fish. So this is also a symbiosis type of relationship, but this provides the cleaning mechanism or the cleaning activity or cleaning service to the moray eels by the cleaner shrimps. So in return the cleaner shrimps gets the food, and the moray eels get the service of the cleaning of the teeth by the cleaner shrimp. So this is also an example of the cleaning symbiosis or the mutualism. Then third type of association, that is antagonistic associations or the parasitism. So in this interspecific association, antagonism or a parasitism, in this interspecific association, one of the partner is benefited and the other get harm or certain disease or the injury. Therefore, this type of relationship is also called as antagonism. So this is antagonism is a animal association between the animal association between the organisms of the two different species, or the interspecific association. In this case, one partner of the relationship is benefited and other get harmed or injured, and therefore this is a type of relationship also called as antagonism or parasitism. So we'll explain the parasitism. So the parasite or parasitism is a Greek term, para besides, and sitos means food. So the original meaning of the word parasite was one who eats another's table, one who eats at another's table, or one who lives at the another's expense. Or simply, it means the parasite lives or the parasite survive on the cost of its host. Means the host organism has to suffer certain disease or certain injury, or a host organism always get harmed by certain injury or the disease, and the parasitic organism, which is usually smaller and get benefited for its need or the requirement, maybe the food, reproduction, space for living, transportation. So there are so many requirements or the needs of the parasitic organisms that could be satisfied or provided by the host organism. So in this case, the parasite lives at the cost of host, means the host has to suffer from certain disease or injury, or the host always gets certain loss from the relationship, that is the parasitism, and parasite always get benefited and the host always gets certain harm or a disease. So the parasitism is a unique kind of symbiotic relationship. Parasitism is a unique type of symbiotic relationship in which the parasite remains very close to its food or host. It is defined as an animal. The parasite is defined as an animal or plant which lives partially or completely at the cost of another organism, that is host. The parasite is always benefited and the host is always get injured or harmed or diseased. The parasite-host relationship is called as parasitism. When the parasite lives on the surface of body of the host, it is called as ectoparasite. For example, head louse, ticks, mites, bed bugs, leeches, mosquitoes, fleas, all of these organisms, they are ectoparasitic and which are feeding upon the blood of its host organism. So when the parasite lives inside the body of host is called as endoparasite. So the organisms which are living on the surface of body of the host called as ectoparasites, and the examples of which are head louse, ticks, mites, bed bugs, leeches, mosquitoes, fleas, etc. So all of these are the ectoparasitic insects or arthropods, and which are usually sucking the blood from the different animals or its host organism, and are thus called as ectoparasites. And when the animals or the parasites live inside the body of host, then is called as endoparasites. For example, malarial parasite Plasmodium vivax, which lives in the red blood cells of the man and causing the disease malaria. Majority of the parasites live in the harmonious equilibrium or with a friendly relation or association with their host. So majority of the parasites usually live with a complete harmony or with a friendly relationship, so as to maintain the equilibrium with their host and can get a continued supply of its need or its food or support from the host organisms. Most of the times, the parasites are pathogenic. Most of the times, parasites are pathogenic and producing a disease in the host. And this happens usually when their number becomes unusually high, or whenever there is a hyperinfection or hyperinfestation of the parasite in or on the body of host, resulting into a certain disease or the pathogenic condition, and this will lead to the disease, or this may lead to the death of the host. For example, the Entamoeba histolytica. It is a protozoan parasite of the man, lives in the small intestine and causes amoebic dysentery. So this is the example of the endoparasite, which is a protozoan parasite, namely Entamoeba histolytica. So this protozoan parasite lives in the small intestine of the human being and causing amoebic dysentery. Cameron stated that the parasite is an organism. Cameron stated that the parasite is an organism which is dependent for some essential metabolite or some essential metabolic need or a factor on another organism called as host. So this is the definition defined by the Cameron, that the parasite is an organism which is dependent for some essential metabolic need or a factor on another organism called as host. Parasitism is the intimate or a close association or the relationship between the host and parasite. The parasites are generally smaller than their host. The parasites are usually smaller than their host and depends upon its host for the needs such as nutrition or a food, then habitat, that is a space for living, then developmental stimuli so as to complete its life cycle. Some sort of larval stages can be completed in the body of host, that is a developmental stimuli, then enzymes, vitamins, control of maturation, reproduction, and even the transportation. So these are the different needs or the requirements of the parasites which could be satisfied by the parasite from the host organism. If host dies due to overexploitation or overuse or a hyperinfestation or hyperinfection, ultimately the parasite also dies or get perish. So if host dies due to overinfection or infestation or overexploitation or the use of the host organism, ultimately the parasite also get died or get perish due to the complete loss or a disease in a host organism. So ultimately, if there is a death of host, there is an ultimate death of the parasite also. Examples of parasitism. So first example, already we have explained one example, that is Entamoeba histolytica, parasite protozoan living in the small intestine and causing amoebic dysentery in man. So this is another example of the endoparasite, that is Ascaris lumbricoides, commonly called as roundworm. So another example of the parasitism, that is Ascaris and man. Ascaris lumbricoides or the roundworm is the most common intestinal worm found in the human being. So this is the most common endoparasite or the intestinal parasite, commonly called as roundworm, found in the intestine of the human being. It is more common in children than adults due to the some sort of unhygienic conditions or less care taken by the children. So due to the unhygienic conditions in the children, usually the occurrence of Ascaris is more in children than the adults. So it is more common in children than adults. This worm feed on the semi-digested food of the host in the small intestine. So this roundworm Ascaris lumbricoides feeding on the semi-digested food of the human intestine. Ascaris protect themselves from being digested by their host due to presence of thick cuticle on their body and secretes and anti-enzymes which protects them from the digestive juice of the host and will not be digested in the body of human host. So these are the adaptations. These are the adaptations found in the Ascaris lumbricoides or the roundworm, that is presence of thick cuticle and secretion of anti-enzymes. Presence of thick cuticle on around its body, and it secretes anti-enzymes which will neutralize the digestive juice of the human being and thus ultimately get protected from its digestion into the human intestine. Thus, Ascaris is an obligatory endoparasite of the man. Obligatory parasite means a permanent parasite. Ascaris cannot exist. Ascaris cannot survive without the human host. So it is the obligatory or the permanent endoparasite of the man living in the intestine and lead comfortable or easy and successful parasitic life and exhibits a good example of the parasitism. But in this case, human being always suffer from certain diseases, maybe deficiency diseases. Maybe a deficiency diseases can lead to into the deficiency of the different vitamins, or can lead to the anemia due to the presence or the attack or infection of the Ascaris in the human being. So, Ascaris lumbricoides is the endoparasite, permanent parasite living in the human intestine and can feed onto the semi-digested food from the intestine. So, ultimately resulting into a malnutrition or a deficiency of the number of nutrients or the vitamins, and thus this can lead to certain disease in the human being, maybe deficiency diseases or the anemia, or can lead into a stunted growth in the human being. Then another example, that is lice and human. Lice is a human parasite. Lice is a human parasite, or it is a ectoparasite living in the head region, benefiting at the expense of the human host. Lice, or the head lice, or the body lice. So there are three kind of lice, and which are attacking or infesting the body of the human or the head region particularly, and sucking the blood with the help of piercing and sucking type of mouth parts, and acts as a ectoparasite of the human being, and it lives at the cost of its human host. So the lice is human parasite benefiting at the expense of its human host. The symbiotic relationship between a human head and lice is a parasitism. So it is a parasitic type of relationship, or parasitism type of relationship, where the lice get benefited and human always get loss or suffer from a loss in the form of damage, that is a irritation in the skin or annoyance, or the loss of the blood resulting into anemia, or sometimes the lice may transmit certain viruses causing different diseases. The symbiotic relationship between the human head and the lice is a parasitism, because the lice gets food in the form of blood, then shelter and the place for their nesty eggs. While man is harmed, however, the relationship is parasitic, as the lice takes or the suck up the blood and causing anemia, then irritation due to the secretion of some metabolites like urine or excrement or the saliva, and this leads to the irritation on the human skin in the region wherever it is attacking or infesting. But no return benefit to the human host. But there is no any return benefit to the human host. But sometimes lice can transmit certain diseases to the human host. So this is the loss of the human host, and this is a parasitic type of relationship, or a parasitism type of relationship, where lice is always benefited and the human always get certain loss, either in the form of anemic situation or an irritation, or sometimes the diseases due to the transmission of disease causing agents or the pathogens to the human being by the lice. Then next point, prey predation between the lion and the deer. Prey predation between the lion and deer. So predation is a biological interaction where one organism, that is a predator, kills and eat another organism, that is a prey. So predation is a biological interaction that is usually found in the nature or in the ecosystem, where usually the carnivorous animals or the animals which are usually larger in size, having a carnivore type of feeding habit, which are predating upon the another smaller organisms which may be herbivores, and serves as a prey for the predators or the predator organisms. So prey predation between the lion and deer. So this is the example of the prey predation, lion and the deer. Lion serves as a predator and a deer serves as a prey. So predation is a biological interaction. Predation is a biological interaction where one organism, that is a predator, kills and eat another organism, that is a prey. Predators choose prey selectively based on age or condition. Condition may be fresh or dead, so condition. So predators always choose the prey, or predators select its prey or choose its prey selectively based on the age or the conditions. The mountain lions, the mountain lions, Puma concolor, selectively predate upon the mule, a deer, Podocelus hemionus. So this is the genus and species of the deer, Podocelus hemionus, and the Puma concolor, genus and species of the lions. So mountain lions, Puma concolor, selectively predate upon the mule, deer, that is Podocelus hemionus, infected with a chronic wasting disease, a prion disease. So these are the conditions. These are conditions which are found among the deers. So such type deers are chosen or selected by the lions as their prey. Young deers are most vulnerable or sensitive to the mountain lion predation. Young deers or the herbivores are most vulnerable or sensitive to the mountain lion predation. A predator lion is an animal. A predator, that is a lion, is an animal that attacks, kills, and feeds on another organism, that is a prey deer. Prey deer. The predator typically hunts live prey. The predator, that is a lion, typically hunts a live prey, which it kills outright, and devour its flesh, and devour or eat its flesh or drinks the blood. The predation is commonly associated with the idea of strong attacking the weak. The predation is commonly associated with an idea of strong, usually the strong, that is a predator, strong attacking the weak, that is a prey. For example, the lion pouncing upon the deer. The lion pouncing or attacking the deer. The lion pouncing upon the deer, the hawk upon the sparrow, the hawk, which is again a carnivore bird attacking on the sparrow, small bird, the frog upon the insects. So these are the some type of examples of the prey and predators. So predator-prey relationship. So the predation is commonly associated with the idea of the strong attacking or devouring the weak. For example, the lion pouncing upon the deer, the hawk upon the sparrow, or the frog upon the insects, etc. Predators have evolved efficient mechanisms to capture and kill the prey, predators have evolved or having such type of modifications or the adaptations. So predators have evolved efficient mechanisms or the adaptations or the modifications in them so as to capture and kill their prey. But prey have responded to natural selection. But the prey have responded to the natural selection by evolving mechanisms. So prey organisms are also having some mechanisms or the adaptations to escape or to hide from the predators. To escape or to hide from the predators means both predator and prey, both of are having a certain type of adaptations or the adaptations or the modifications or the mechanisms so as to protect themselves. Means the prey organisms are having certain mechanisms so as to protect themselves, or the predators are having some mechanism so as to catch, so as to kill its prey. Predation is helpful in the regulation of the population size. Usually, this prey and predator relationship, prey and predator relationship is very useful or helpful in regulation or in maintaining the population size of the particular region or the area. The predators can maintain themselves only when their prey is present. The predators can survive or the predators can maintain themselves or their number only when the prey organisms are present in the particular region. So the predators can maintain themselves only when their prey is present. If a predator caused the extinction of its prey population, if there is a overpredation or if there is a more number of predators present in the particular region, can lead into a extinction of its prey population. So if a predator caused the extinction of its prey population, it would be also become extinct. Ultimately, this will lead to the extinction of the predators. So if the predators overpredating or overfeeding onto its prey, ultimately the prey population will be finished. Prey population will be finished. So ultimately this will lead into the extinction of the prey species, and this will be ultimate extinction of the predators. Predators may exert an influence on prey population. Predators do exert an influence on prey population. They often keep a prey populations below the level of carrying capacity of the ecosystem. Predators can influence or exert the prey population, and often maintaining the prey population or the number below the level of the carrying capacity of the ecosystem. So this is what about the prey predation. So with this, we have finished with the topic fifth. We have finished with the topic fifth, that is animal interactions. So in this topic, we have explained different points such as the different type of animal interactions. That is the definition of the animal interaction, or how they are useful, or how they are affecting the particular ecosystem or the habitat or the nature or the community. And we have explained that is what is the resource, what is the consumer, how they are interacting with one another and maintaining the natural balance, or how they are affecting the adverse effects on the nature or the ecosystem. We have explained different type of animal interactions, that is competitive interactions, consumer resource interactions, detritivore detritus interaction, mutualistic interactions. So these are the four different type of animal interactions. Together with, we have explained the competition, that is interspecific or intraspecific competition, or the competition that is on the basis of various modes, such as direct interference type of the competition, or the resource use type of competition, or intraspecific competitions. Then we have explained the different aspects of the competition, that is competition for food or space or moisture or the light and protections. So how the resource and the different organisms or the species of the community or the ecosystem, how interacting in the nature. Then competition between the sexes, that is so as to satisfy the breeding activities, how there are various influences by the organisms so as to exhibit the mating behavior. Then courtship. Then we have explained the beneficial associations, that is symbiosis, then phoresis, then commensalism, then different examples of the commensalism, that is cattle, aggregates and livestock, then phoretic or transport commensalism, synosious commensalism, their examples, then protection and camouflage commensalism, cleaning commensalism with their examples, then mutualism, that is the exchange of the needs between the partners of the relationship, that is the mutualism, where so we have explained the examples of the wood-eating termites and the flagellate protozoans, honeybees and the flowers, then cleaning symbiosis of the fish by the prawns or shrimps. Then we have explained the antagonism or the parasitism, where the one partner is always benefited, parasite is always benefited from its host, that is another partner always getting certain disease or a loss or a damage by the parasitic organism. Then we have explained the examples of the parasitism, that is Entamoeba histolytica, protozoan parasite living in the human intestine and causing amoebic dysentery, then endoparasites such as Ascaris living in the human intestine, then ectoparasites like lice attacking or sucking the blood of the human host and causing anemia or the irritation, and can also transmit certain diseases in the human being. So these are, we have explained several subtopics in the topic animal interaction. Then lastly, we have explained the prey and predation with the example of lion and deer. So this is about the entire topic animal interactions. So this is a slide showing certain questions on the topic animal interactions, which you can write in a separate notebook. But so as to write the answers of these questions, that is a full question or the short answer questions, you have to observe the entire videos on a landscape mode. Then whatever the explanation or the description which I have given in the slides, that is referred from the textbook of the Nirali publication. The author is Dr. Kishore Pawar and his colleagues. So you can refer the textbook of the animal ecology published by the Nirali publication. So with this, today we have completed your entire syllabus, your contents of the entire syllabus of the paper 2nd and the section 1 or a semester 1, the course title, that is the animal ecology. So today we have finished the complete syllabus of the course of the semester 1, zoology paper 2nd, section 1 or a semester 1, the course animal ecology. So you can observe all the videos and can study with the notes provided in the slides. So with this, Today we'll stop here and very soon we'll conduct the internal test for the 20 marks. The questions will be the objective questions from the entire syllabus of the course Animal Ecology. So with this, today we'll stop here. Best of luck, take care, maintain the social distancing, wear the mask whenever you go out, avoid the crowding, maintain social distance and maintain your personal hygiene, self-cleanliness, and best of luck. So with this, I will stop here. Thank you.